Green than normal this morning. Happy St. Patrick's Day. And we are thankful to be in the house of the Lord today. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us pray. Father, thank you for a God who loved us so much. You sent your one and only Son to die on our behalf. And we thank you because of his death and resurrection, we are here today. We pray that your Holy Spirit would bless our worship, anoint the word, and fill us afresh with a new knowledge of you. And we ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise. What a priest we have in Jesus.
He is our source of eternal salvation.
He sympathizes with us in our weakness.
He offers prayers and supplications for us.
He serves us and sacrifices himself for us.
What a priest we have in Jesus.
Though Jesus is our great high priest, we have lived as if we did not need him, as though our sin was not dire and deadly. Despite our self-centered failures, our Heavenly Father is merciful, and because of Jesus, he invites us to draw near to his throne in confidence to ask for forgiveness. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against our neighbors and against you. We have sought to be served. We have demanded others sacrifice for us. Forgive us, renew us, and humble us for the sake of Jesus. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, sent Jesus into our world to be our great high priest, who came to serve and offer his life as a ransom for us. Christ died and is risen for you. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore remind you that you are forgiven of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are forgiven. Christ has sacrificed his life for us. Please take a moment and share the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ with those around you. Our first reading this morning is from Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16. How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, O Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips, I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of our gospel. From Mark chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. They replied, let one of us sit at your right hand and the other at your left in your glory. You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May be seated.
Thank you.
Good morning. It's great to see you here today. The text that Pastor Steve read, to make this make a little bit better sense, I think I got to read the pretext, the two verses that come right before the text today. Mark chapter 10, verses 32 through 34 go like this. They were on their way up to Jerusalem, and Jesus said, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed by the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and they will condemn him to death. They will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him, spit on him, flog him, kill him, and 3 days later he will rise." And then the text, "Hey teacher, we want you to give to us whatever we ask." Wow. Just think about that for a second. Jesus just drops this bombshell. By the way, guys, we're going up to Jerusalem for a purpose. That purpose is I'm going to be killed. They're going to mock me, spit on me, crucify me. Hey, Jesus, give us whatever we want. I think they missed the social cues. They were so focused in on themselves that they didn't even have a clue what Jesus was talking about. Ever been there? I have. We ask this primordial, most basic of questions to God. God, I need something from you now. And we miss the point of the gospel. We see God as kind of a genie in the bottle, and we rub it just right, and he pops out, and he gives us 3 wishes, and we go on, and life is happy, happy, happy. But that's not really how it worked according to the text. The text said he was being led by the Spirit up to Jerusalem, where he would be spit on, mocked, and crucified. But 3 days later, he would rise. That's where we're headed, folks. That's indeed this Lenten season that we're in. And so to understand the Lenten season that we're in, let's see here. I got to get to the right thing. Red, I'm going to have to ask you, thank you. I'm not seeing it up here, and I can't remember how to do that again. So my bad. So I'm just going to have to call on you. So, Red, I'm going to ask you to go to the next slide where it says, "We are ransomed." This is kind of what the text says. As a matter of fact, a number of people have said, Titus chapter 2, verse 14, which I printed up for you up there, "He gave himself for us to be redeemed from all the lawlessness and purify for himself a people for his possession whom are zealous for good works." That's actually kind of a summary of the text that Pastor Steve read just a minute ago, where Jesus said, "Can you guys take on the cup that I'm going to drink?" No, not really, but yes, kind of, and we'll get back to that in a minute. But the purpose of that is that you would learn to be a servant, and that's actually what this talks about, being zealous for good works, being a servant who follows in the image of the one who would die. Now, interestingly, that word redeem up there and in Mark chapter 10, verse 45, it's the same Greek word. The word is lutron, not Lutheran, but lutron. Luo means to loosen in Greek. It means to unchain somebody who was bound up. It means to unfurl the things that were holding them back. And lutron means to be set free. And in order for that to happen, there's a couple of things that we need to understand. First, we need to understand that we're captive. What? We live in the U.S., land of freedom. We're not captive to anything, anybody. Yeah, we are. We're not politically captive. We're not captive in the sense that we are enchained, enslaved, per se, but we are captive. And we need a ransom. A ransom, you know, if a kidnapper has your child and they send you a note and it says it's $1 million to get your kid back, that's a ransom note. And actually what Jesus is saying in this text is he said, "I have come to buy you out of the slavery that you're under, and I'm going to pay the ransom price." Now we may not think in those terms, but that's actually what we need is somebody to pay the full price, the $1 million ransom fee. We need a whole new start, a whole new life, a new purpose, a new power, a new way of relating to the divine. Because see, there were lots of ways of relating to the divine, but they all were captive. They all had captivating things about them. And they were based in fear. Fear of God. Fear of not being enough. Fear that it wasn't enough. Fear that my own righteousness wasn't going to stack up. At the end of time, I was going to be weighed. And if I was found wanting, it was trouble. A way of doing away with that whole system is what Jesus is saying. I've come that you might have a new way of relating. And so let's talk about that. What are we in bondage to? What are we needing ransom from? So there's all kinds of things that we are in bondage to, and we hate to even think about it, but it's the reality of life. We are in bondage to what we would call bad masters. Think about that for a second. Bad masters. The first one that I want to think about with you is from 2 Timothy 3:2, and it says, people will be lovers of themselves. People are turned in on themselves by nature. That's who we are, and it's what we do. That's not a healthy self-confidence kind of being turned in on yourself, but that's actually kind of a, I'm in it for me. My feelings get hurt when things don't go according to Hoyle. I'm always comparing myself to others. Nobody treats me right. Ever felt that way? I'm the center of my universe. We're turned in on ourselves. Luther and Augustine wrote about this. They called it incurvatus se, being so curved in on yourself that all you think about is you. And we all have that in us as a bad master. Second, dear children, keep yourselves from idols. 1 John 5:21. That's actually the very last word in the book of 1 John. Isn't that interesting that he would end with that passage? Keep yourself from idols. Huh. Must be important. You always start strong and end strong, right? Put your big doozy at the end there. And so that's what John does in 1 John. And he says, keep yourselves from idols. Now, idols? What? We're not captive to idols. We don't plant little statues in the ground and pray for fertility like the people way back in the day, right? No. At least most of you, maybe if you're a really ritualistic gardener, perhaps, but most of you don't do that. But what does an idol look like in this day, in this age? I'm actually reading a book right now by a guy named David Zahn. It's called Seculosity. Seculosity. It's a very interesting premise. He basically says that capital R religion, where people show up to places like you guys are this morning, is actually on the decline in the United States of America. But small R religion, and not just in the United States, but around the world, seems to be on the rise. He cites some interesting things from Europe. For example, he says half of people in Sweden believe in mental telepathy. Interesting. The majority of people in Iceland believe in elves. Okay. In Austria, a third of the people attribute real power to lucky charms. And I'm not talking about the cereal. I'm talking about little rabbit's foot or whatever, but some kind of a charm that you would carry with you. People have this belief in spirituality, but not in quote-unquote religion. There is a rise in the largest growing religious demographic in the United States is a group called the nuns. And that's not N-U-N-S, as in a Catholic nun. It's nuns. They have no affiliation whatsoever. They see themselves as deeply spiritual, but not religious. The premise of his book, though, goes on to say that it's really about the way we pursue things in our daily life. And it's not so much that we want people in our culture don't so much want a relationship with the vertical, they want a horizontal relationship. And this is how people are living out their spirituality. And his 10 chapters or so relate to these things as being the idols of our day. Busyness. Interesting. How you doing, Bill? Oh, I'm doing great, just busy as a one-armed paper hanger. And that's somehow a merit that says, I'm important. My defining thing in life is to have things to do, and I find my importance from being busy. It's an idol. politics. When my guy wins, everything's going to be okay, right? Politics is salvation for many. It's an idol. You know what? Every candidate's a broken human, and they ain't going to fix it because we're all broken people. Don't make politics into an idol. Work. Work. I have my identity solely from what I do. Instead of a human being, I'm a human who does. I'm a human doing. Parenting, technology, leisure, being a fan. Being a fan is an idol to many. It's the most important thing in your life. If the Cowboys win or lose, who am I looking at, Janice? Okay. Just kidding. These things can become idols to each of us. Food. Leisure. And he goes on and on. It's an excellent book. I would commend it to you. Seculosity. We need ransoming from these bad masters. These things that are we find our full identity in. And if just this happens, then I'm okay. You're never going to be okay if it has to do with any of those things. You're only going to be okay if the one who sacrificed for you is center to your life. Another bad master, believe it or not, you know, Psalm 119 that we read earlier says, I love the law of the Lord. But the law of the Lord is a bad master. Think about it. What's the job of the law? Pastor Steve said it in our Lenten service. It's to show us our sin. If the law is our master, and all it does is show us our sins, it's going to spiral you down into this place where there's a lot of guilt and shame, but there's not a lot of hope. But there is a master who would die that you might live. And that master shows us kind of the key to this in the passages that we'll see here in just a second up on the screen. That's my cue, Red. Thank you. Thank you. Check out these ways the word the cup, which was central to our passage, the gospel passage, was used. These are Old Testament passages that talk about the cup. Awake, awake, rise up, Jerusalem, you who have drunk from the hand of the Lord the cup of his wrath. Whoa. You who drained it to its dregs, the goblet that makes people stagger. The cup of wrath that makes you stagger. Does that sound like a cup you want to drink? No, thank you. Not so much. Ezekiel 23, you will be filled with drunkenness and sorrow, the cup of ruin and desolation. You will drink it and drain it and chew on its pieces, and you will tear at your breasts. This cup has to do with the judgment of God. And Jesus is talking and he says, I'm going up to Jerusalem to drink the cup. I'm going up to Jerusalem to drink the cup. I'm taking on wrath, ruin, desolation, tearing at my breasts. It's terrible. Why? Why is this necessary? Why is this ransom price so steep? Well, it's because, and we've said this many times, but it's because the Creator is so invested in His creation that He is furious when it's messed with. You know, I went to Yellowstone three summers ago, and while getting ready to go there, we knew we were going to take some hikes back off of some of the main trails, and it's grizzly country. And so all of the warning stuff that says just one thing, most important thing when you're in grizzly country, never get between a mama and her, what, cubs? Yeah. Why is a mama bear so furious, so ferocious when you get between her and her cubs? Because she loves them. And she's afraid you're going to destroy them. And so she's going to do everything, and that means tearing you to pieces because of her love for her cubs, that innate bond that happens between a mother and her creation. Same bond is between God and His creation, the Father and His children, furious love for you. And the things that mess you up and separate you from Him, He's furious about. And there's a price that has to be paid. And He's going to do anything He can to reunite the two. And that means fury. And that means destruction. And that means wrath that would stagger you. It means ruin and desolation if you get between Him and His purpose. And Jesus says, I'm going to do that. I'm going to step into that place where the wrath occurs. I'm going to step into that place where the destruction and the fury and the ferocious hate and love of God mix. Because He loves you so much, He's going to do everything He can to bring you back to Himself and reunite you with Him. And that means that something has to be done. And that something is the cup. His imminent crucifixion was on the line, and His guys are saying, hey, give us whatever we want. Oh my. And yet He goes to the garden for them. Think about that for a second. This is on the way to the garden. He's going to the garden, and He says, hey, just stay up and pray with me. Just be awake and pray. And He goes, and He talks to the Father, and He said, Father, if you can, please take this cup from me. But not my will, but yours. And He comes back and He sees the guys sleeping. These knuckleheads. These guys. And yet He goes. And all of a sudden, here comes one of His followers who's betraying Him with a kiss, Judas, right? And Peter gets out his sword and whacks off an ear, and Jesus says, put that away. For I am going to drink the cup that the Father has told me to drink. John chapter 18. The cup. He knew all along that He would take on the cup of God's wrath, and He does it even though He didn't have to. Father, if it would be Your will, please take this from me, but not my will, Yours be done. And He doesn't hear. Now I'm going to provide a way. Just trust me, son, is what He hears. And He goes towards the cup, towards the place that you and I are not capable of going. And even just the thought of the cup while Jesus is praying in the garden, that prayer that He just prayed, it so overwhelms Him. And this is what medical people will tell you, that if you have a severe shock sets in, your capillaries will burst and you will sweat blood. That's what happened to Jesus. Just the thought of the fury of God, the thought of the cup that He had to drink, caused Him to sweat blood. It's like He was looking straight down into the furnace that Nebuchadnezzar had fired up to 5,000 degrees, and He knew that's where He was going. And yet He goes. He goes. And He pays a ransom price. He takes on the fury, the anger, in order to make us new. In order to give us a hope, perfect love, agape, selfless love, and it frees us from ourselves. So then the question is this, the cup for you? At the end of that passage Pastor Steve read, Jesus and the disciples are talking, and He said, don't you know what you're asking? After they say, hey, give us whatever we want. He just tells them that He's going to Jerusalem to be crucified. They say, give us whatever we want. It's so funny. He says, can you drink the cup or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? The answer to that is, duh, no. No, it's a rhetorical question. They can't do what He has to do. They can't take on the cup that He is going to take on. But in a way, they do. He says this a few verses later, you will drink the cup and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. What's going on there? He says yes and no. It's confusing. Let me say this. It's think about it as a capital C cup. Like He's taking on the ultimate cup. But He's saying, yes, you will also have your cup. Your cup is kind of a small C cup. It's not the big cup that's going to win you righteousness. It's not the one that's going to pay the ransom price. But it is a cup. There will be consequences for following me. Think about it this way for a second. Let's say someone saves your life miraculously somehow. They intervene in a situation and your death was imminent, but they save you. And you are so thankful and grateful. And you go to them and you say, is there anything I can do? Thank you so much for saving my life. I'm going to get to see my grandkids' weddings and, you know, whatever the story is. It's such a blessing to have life on this earth still continuing. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And they say, you say, well, is there anything I can do for you? And they say, yeah, I need some help with a family member. Would you check in on them once a week and maybe mow their lawn? Yeah, of course I will. I'd be delighted. Thank you for allowing me a way to return some of what was given to me, this gift. Thank you. That's what Jesus is saying here. He's saying, you are going to take on this cup of servanthood like I have taken on. It's not going to be the same. It's not going to win your life with God forever, but it's going to do something good. Martin Luther said, God doesn't need our good works, but our neighbor sure does. It's true. Your neighbor does. Some of your neighbors in this room need your good works. And that's actually kind of where it leaves us. It says, Jesus says, I am now sending you to serve. You will take on the cup. Your cup isn't the big cup that wins eternal salvation. Your cup is the small cup. And you will serve wantingly and willingly because your life has been given to you. A whole new way of being, a way that you don't have to prove yourself over and over. You don't have to try and find your purpose in seculosity. You don't have to try and find your purpose in keeping of the law perfectly. You don't have to try and find your purpose in being curved in on yourself and saying, oh, how's this day going to go for me? You have a bigger purpose, a higher calling, a longer view. A wider perspective, an eternal perspective. Dietrich Bonhoeffer has this in a book called Life Together. He says, people by nature size up one another when they meet them. What can this person do for me is the core question. He says, but after encountering Christ, this begins to change. What can I do for them? What do they need to thrive and grow? How can they come to know the grace that I have received? What can I do to serve them towards that purpose? That's what starts to happen in us as the cup gets passed. In a few minutes, we're going to take the cup. Think about it. That cup brings you renewal. That cup gives you new life. That cup brings forgiveness of sins. That cup calls you to serve. It calls you to not just think about yourself. How can I think about others? What can I do for them? What do they need to thrive? How can I pour myself into people with as much energy and passion and purpose as I would put into my own self? How can I do that? The answer is the cup. Let's pray. Father, as we drink the cup this morning, we're so thankful that you've set us free and started us on a new path. We've met you as the God who's paid the ransom price. You've bought us away from things that we thought mattered, but really in the big picture are a pile of beans. Lord, help us to live under the authority of one who gave himself fully for us. We thank you that you were obedient to drink of the cup of wrath, the cup of salvation, and we thank you that we get to participate in that same cup today. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to invite you to stand as we boldly proclaim the words of the Apostles' Creed, who God is, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and he descended into hell. And the third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
In your bulletins, we got back our little inserts. I think a lot of you have gotten those paper inserts where you can submit your prayer request and also help us stay connected with you. You can also do it online to the address that's on the screen. And just thank you for your giving and thank you for your service to help us make this ministry work. May the Lord bless your giving now. Thank you, Lucas. It says in the book of Psalms, praise the Lord with stringed instruments. And we thank God for musicians that can do that. And also for musicians that teach others to do that. Maybe some of you will be doing what he is doing in the weeks and the years to come. We give thanks that on the night when Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread, and after he broke it, he gave thanks and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, drink, this is the blood of the new covenant, that is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for your body and blood that strengthens us and preserves us. We give you thanks and praise for this greatest sacrifice that was made on our behalf. We thank you for we have been the recipients of your grace, having our sins forgiven and have been given the gift of eternal life. And Lord, we thank you that your ransom paid not only for our eternity, but you also hear our prayers now. And Lord, we pause right now because you know the needs that we, each of us individually, have that are burdensome on our heart. So Lord, we pause this moment and ask you to hear our prayers. Thank you, Father. We pray, Lord, for all of these needs we have just brought before you. And we also give thanks to you for the birth of Mateo. Bless him, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We pray for your healing for Nancy McCormick and Carol Hall. We pray for comfort for Doug Brutleg's family as Doug mourns the loss of his mother. Thank you that you know all our needs inside and out, and you are there to meet our needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus our Lord. And now we pray that prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A few items that are important to us and our ministry here at Grace. Next Sunday afternoon is our big outreach, Egg Patch Palooza. And tell the person next to you, I am so thankful you're willing to help. We need volunteers for today, because after the service today in here, we are going to be stuffing thousands of eggs. Next week, we need help. It's going to take place between 3 and 5 in the afternoon. And the more help we have, the more effective we can be to our community. Please take note of the Holy Week schedule that's printed in your bulletin. And today begins a new Bible study with Pastor Doug. The adults will meet in MR2, correct? And we have one last Lenten service this week, Wednesday night at 4:30 and 6:30 with dinner in between. Please rise. Hear the words of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord make his countenance to shine upon you and to give you peace. Amen. Anyone who would like some personal prayer, feel free to join Nancy and Dolores, who would love to pray for you, probably right over here against that wall. Go in peace, serve the Lord.